slid past us. And we really don't, and if you, even if you look at the platforms, there's not much of substance outside of the one promise for pharmacare in any of the three parties in terms of what they say they will do, other than the other two parties say they'll be nice to the Bremers, which they always say, but they don't always, they haven't always been.
Okay, the third question is concerning the role of incumbency in the election. Just going to clarify your question, whether incumbents have an advantage, disadvantage?
Well, I mean, I guess in this election campaign, often there is some advantage to incumbency, and I know especially too with the kind of liberal surge, they're moving from a very fairly small number of seats to taking a lot of new seats, and so. Is the incumbency factor just not going to be a significant factor for some reason? Or if it is a significant factor, how might that affect the results?
Well, it's never a factor in a sweep, which makes this election kind of interesting. Because we all agree that there's a minority government. One would think the incumbency factor is huge. But there's a problem. There's also this issue across the whole country right now in specific areas about getting rid of Harper or not getting rid of Harper. So the problem that I'm having answering that question in any kind of intelligent way, probably the same problem I've had answering that question in intelligent way, but I don't know whether we're going to get a real sense until Monday of what areas of the country are really thinking in this election in terms of sweeping out Harper or keeping him in. Where they want to keep him in, which is probably the West, you're going to see incumbents as a huge factor. So the old politicians that they're comfortable with are the ones that they're going to re-elect. Interestingly, though, there's less incumbents this election than there is on average. Like, I mean, particularly on the federal government, on the side of the conservative, they've had a huge turnover. So they have their issues. Even here, it's become a big factor because of seat changes, redistribution, which is another factor. You're dealing with a different MP than you might have. So all I'm going to say is Ralph Goodloe will likely win this incumbent.
The one, Canada doesn't have a strong incumbency effect anyway. Even our MPs have pretty short lifespans, and it's because we've got these three parties, usually a volatile partisanship. What's really interesting is the Conservatives did try to game the system, right? So the long campaign favored them in terms of their spending, and numbers vary a little bit, but people say there's something in the order of $600 million in infrastructure spending that went out the door over the course of the summer. And depending how you crunch the numbers, made it look like some of it went into ridings that were going to vote for it disproportionately. It doesn't seem, we'll know Tuesday if it really worked, but that would be maybe one test of that, is there are some fun GIS maps of where this money got spent. Overlay it on who voted where, and we'll be able to tell. But the Conservatives really tried hard within the limits of the law to game it, and I don't think it's worked for them.
No, I think, you know, again, one of the things that was actually quite interesting about this going into the campaign was how many, especially on the government side, members of Parliament bailed, right, and said, I'm not running. And yeah, some big names. There were a couple of ones who really wanted to run and no one would nominate them. But those, you know, that was more rare than the, you know, they lost a lot of their incumbency. And you know, in a kind of a close election like this, you would want some of those familiar names and faces down on the ground knocking on doors, and they're not going to be there in the last. And so that may have some impact.
One quick local observation: look what happened to Lynn Yelich, who was one of the faces, supposedly, of the federal government here. It speaks to the issues of how absolutely unimportant the individual MPs are, and even how disposable they are to their political parties. And I find that, particularly a woman, who, you know, they always promote as needing, which they obviously do, that they would just dispense and discard with her as a junior minister, simply because it doesn't matter. And I think they realize it doesn't.
Any other questions? Yes.
I have a question about strategic voting, which Jim mentioned early on. I think I disagree, Jim, about strategic voting, especially in Regina. It seems to me there's no better case really for strategic voting than in Regina-Louvain, where where the race is between the Conservatives and the NDP, and the Liberals trade distant, are trailing by probably quite a lot from what I've seen. The other factor is that in Saskatchewan, the Liberal organization is very weak, right? So we've got Ralph Goodale, and I don't know that we've elected a Liberal MP for more than 20 or 30 years outside of Ralph Goodale. So I'd like to hear maybe Murray and Tom comment on whether they think strategic voting is actually effective and whether we have enough information to do that.
Well, in the writing, you're...
Let's take two more questions. Sure. Yes, please.
So my question is about Western disenfranchisement. So in previous elections, that's been a huge key in, I think, why the Conservative government had a majority. How do you think that plays out in this election? Is it an issue? Is it going to determine whether the Conservatives get a minority or not? Or has the issues completely shifted to something that doesn't really involve the Prairies? And with the new NDP in Alberta, how does that affect the national, I guess, page as well?
Okay, one more question. Yes, please.
I think a major issue is like a good number of people are talking about the environment and passing the message about the environment.
In my room?
Yeah. And I was watching, I think, someone from the conference, and he said, according to the rules, that the environment is the second most important issue, and they are doing the job.
Okay, let's start with the strategic voting issue. I disagree with Jim as well. I did strategically vote last time. This is the first time I did it, and I'm going to do it again. I voted for someone
who's
not from the party I tend to support.
Did it work last time?
It worked. And my vote was not wasted.
Sorry, I take exception to the idea that a vote can be wasted. A vote is not wasted.
Well, you know what we mean, though.
I wasted lots.
Wow, there is the... I had the best Twitter conversation with Emma Graney from the Leader Post, talking about elections in Australia that happen on Saturdays, and there's parties and sausage sales outside. Yeah, I want to go. And she said she once voted dressed as a pirate while on a pub crawl in Sydney. And I just think that is the way we need to hold these.
Well, whatever, that's Tuesday.
I think, quite frankly, I think Jim's right. We don't have enough information, really, about where things stand on the local seats, on an Indian seat, to actually say that you know that voting strategically is going to work. Yeah, it looks like, Regina Louvin is, Conservative versus NDP, but the Liberals, it's not clear how far back they are in third.
How do you guys pronounce?
But they're not going to win. Yeah, it's not a chance.
You want a strategic vote in that, right? If you want to get rid of Harper, you vote NDP. It's as simple as that. If you want to keep Harper, you vote for Fraser. But you've got to live with yourself. Like, honest to God, in this particular election, if you firmly believe in the platforms or have a firm idea as what should be going on in this country, I don't know how you can easily change your vote if you've actually been listening to the platform between the NDP and Liberals right now. It's not as easy as it once was. But I think you've hit on the one riding, by the way, where, yeah, of course, like, when the hell are the Liberals ever going to be on the riding that Tony Merchant lives in? Man eats his dog. Yes.
You
can't sue me for that.
It doesn't work in every riding because you really have to do your homework.
If we were having this discussion in Winnipeg or Mississauga, I feel that there'd be enough information. Mm-hmm. But even with the Regina Louvin thing, our last poll showed the Liberals 5 or 6 points back on a sample size that's probably 100 a week ago. We know there's been a huge swing in national support. How does that translate locally? I have no clue, right? I'd be lying if I told you. So I don't know, and I feel if it was a two-way race, right, if it was a very clear two-way race, then that's fine. Mm-hmm. Live with yourself the morning after and we'll strategically. With these weird, 3.5, even 10 points in these new ridings with these big swings at the end. I'm overplaying it a bit, but I don't feel we really know what's going on here or Saskatoon University. My Facebook has seems to have decided I'm going to be supportive. Weird. So I'm constantly getting like the banner as well. Too late. I already voted. But I would argue we just don't know. In other places, sure, fine, but maybe not here.
Yes, writing based. So you do homework regarding your writing. In some cases, it may be more clear cut than most other writing.
Yeah. Yeah. The thing is, we have very little good local poll.
Yes.
Anywhere in the country.
That's so irrelevant if you think about it in the greater scheme of things. How many have you strategic vote in Cyprus? You also know that. It boils down to one, maybe two writings where it can be an effective policy in this province, and I think that's probably proportional to the whole country. So if you're looking at one in every 14 writings where this might be something that affects, I think we spend so much time talking about something.